the main concern.
Well, joining us now from Jerusalem is Dan Meridor, who served as the Israeli justice minister during the Gulf War and a member of the inner security cabinet that really made the key decisions for Israel during this conflict. And Mr. Meridor, thanks for joining us. You once said one of the lessons of the Gulf War was that we know very little and we can predict even less. From your perspective, going into that war, talk about the ways that Israel was ready for it and the ways it clearly was not ready for what happened.
Let me first say this is about one personality, one man, Yitzhak Shamir, who was a leader, unlike what we have today. That is to say, somebody who doesn't ask the people or the pollsters what the people want, but against the public opinion, does what he thinks is right and then convinces them. It was natural for the Israeli psyche, for the Israeli tradition, and it was legitimate and very popular to react. Shamir was sure that it would be a grave mistake, and he led all the rest not to respond, and I'll explain why. But this is a show of leadership that you don't see a lot today. Not doing what would get you votes in the polls, but what you think is right for the public, and done by Shamir, who is known to be a hawk, a strong man, not a liberal, heart-beating guy, as they call him today. Now, back to your question. August 2nd, 1990, the Iraqis invade Kuwait. So we had a very unique opportunity. We had a long time to prepare. It was clear America would not let things stand as they were. It was clear America and others are going to try to take Kuwait back and restore American standing and position in the area. And it was clear that Saddam, he said it, will try to involve Israel in that. So we had time from August 2nd until January 16th, 4 or 5 months, a lot of time to prepare to this war. And I think we did it right. We had cabinet meetings. We had a smaller group of the ministers who met about possible chemical warfare that might be waged at us by Saddam. And I think we were well prepared. What Shamir understood, and some of us, I was one of them, is that this is a very different kind of war. It's not a traditional war that we were used to, where the Arabs attack Israel and they fight each other, and then come the Americans or the world, so to speak, and tries to arrange a ceasefire to stop the fighting and start talking. This was totally different. It was America and a coalition that the Americans and the British put together, including the Arabs, Syria included, against an Arab nation. Israel is not in the traditional position of a fighter. It's in a way a spectator, an outside force that may benefit from the war or lose, may be involved in it, but it's not the main player. And it would be, we thought, not only because the Americans thought so, that if we do attack, we play to the wish, the dream of Saddam Hussein, to paint this picture as an Arab-Jewish war where all the Arabs have to side with him. And this would be wrong for us, of course. So Shamir was strong enough to understand this, smart enough, logical enough, not emotional, and he led the cabinet. The cabinet meetings were held, as you mentioned, and many ministers think to this day that they changed something. Tell me, I'll tell you. I was there and very close to Shamir every day. It was him. There were even times where Misha Ahrens, my very good friend who passed away a short while ago, and a really very good man, had a different opinion. He thought we should react, and he said it openly now. I didn't agree with him. Shamir didn't agree with him, and Shamir was the guy who led it, and he said it would be wrong for us. Don't act on emotion. Don't act on show. Think logically, long-term, what are we doing? And I think we did it right, and any other option would not have changed the war. It's not that we had a trick to play, that if we do it, the war is over. The launchers of rockets in west of Iraq are caught in immediate action, James Bond-like by Israel. It will be shown that on top of tens of thousands of American bombs and TNT and North explosives, we'll add some of ours. It would not change the war, but would have risked, put at risk the whole American operation. So we thought this time was different and we acted differently. Now I have to say, some of you said it earlier, it's a beginning of a new... and nature of war in the Middle East. the old paradigm that we lived by and lived alongside and were in a way concerned of is a massive Arab attack on our borders, and tanks and guns and infantry to really roam over Israel in no time. What can we do against them? The world changed. The countries around us are our friends. Egypt, Begin Sadat, Jordan. We have a different kind of war. We are attacked by missiles from a country that's about 1,000 kilometers away, capital to capital, I think. You can't occupy it or conquer it. You can create damage here and have damage created your place. It's a new, totally new challenge.
Right.
And the wars have changed to this day. The possible Iran-Israel clash, I hope, will not happen. Hezbollah, it's not force that can...
Right, it was it was the forerunner of those threats and conflicts, Mr. Verdi, for sure. I also think it in some ways maybe changed the way of peace in the Middle East, because it could be argued it was the Bush administration involvement in that war that perhaps led into the Madrid conference. And of course, that created a whole set of precedents that move on. Looking at that, how do you see the impact of the Gulf War on all that has happened now, not just in conflict, but just also in diplomacy in the subsequent years?
See, America involved itself in military power in this Iraq war, the first and the second. And then America, parallel to this, had a war in Afghanistan. Huge impact, huge admiration to American technology, and America showed force. But if you hold your breath and think long term, after spending $3 trillion and more, America's asked itself, did it give us a full victory? Did we win in Iraq? Did we win in Afghanistan? Have things changed? And they have changed. And the wish to go to such a kind of war is much less present now. Even the American administration, be it Trump or Romney, would it be, or anybody else? Because not because America is afraid to go to war, but because the results of the traditional war may be very promising in the first days, and then things change. The collapse of the Saddam regime is good, but the collapse of Saddam regime left Iran unchecked by its opponent, Iraq. So it changed in many ways, the Middle East. American involvement was very much there. It changed in the Arab Spring, American policy, which was not very popular in the Arab countries. We have now a Middle East that is very different. And I think that we have made some good progress here. We saw recently the Abraham Accords, as they are called, with the normalization, not peace. We never had war with these countries, but normalization with more countries. We still have the Palestinian issue not resolved. It needs to be resolved. It will not be like that forever. But basically, I think Israel proved itself to be logical and very responsible in the way it acted in the
Mr. Meridor, we...
Mr. Again, out of